TIAA is on a mission. Why? Because 54% of Black Americans don't have enough savings to retire. So in collaboration with big-name artists like Wyclef Jean, TIAA released Paper Right, new music inspiring a new financial future. With 100% of streaming sales going to a nonprofit that teaches students how to invest. Stream Paper Right now and help close the gap.
Hi, you're listening to The Cinemile. I'm Dave. And this is Cathy, my wife.
Hello.
We are walking to the movies to see Coco, the latest Pixar slash Disney animated feature with
Currently,
our son.
Just at the top of the British movie charts this weekend. It smashed through and made £5 million.
So what do you know about this? Because I don't really know much. I saw a trailer a while ago. There was a little boy. There was a guitar. There was the Day of the Dead festival. That's about all I know.
I think that's all we need to know now. I know a bit more, but I won't spoil it. So it's the first Pixar movie to have a Latino cast and a Latino star, and to be set there, which is really cool. It's been really well received.
Set where? Is it Mexico?
In Mexico, yeah. Okay. And it's the highest ever grossing movie that's ever been released in Mexico. It's the most expensive movie ever made. With an all Mexican or all Hispanic cast.
you put a big pause after that. It's the most expensive movie ever made.
Yeah.
With an all Mexican cast.
And to Pixar's credit, they really wanted to do this right. And you know how Pixar tends to have a primary director and then a less experienced co-director. That's kind of how they train up there.
Yeah.
So this is directed by Lee Unkrich.
Go on, you can do this.
But it's
Lee Unkrich.
Co-directed by Adrian Molina, who is of Mexican descent. And Adrian Molina also contributed to the story and apparently helped them redraft it quite a lot. So they've really gone, you know, they've made an effort with this. They want to do it right. Apparently it's very true to the heritage and they've done their research. I've read a couple of Hispanic film reviewers' review of it and they've been very positive about it. So that's really good because Pixar very rarely have, when they depict children, have depicted kind of non-white or...
Well, hang on. Russell from Up,
yes,
is Asian.
Brave has Asian a female American. Protagonist.
Brave is a...
Scottish.
She's Scottish. She's ginger. Ginger people aren't a race.
But this is the first time they've done this culture. And also the first time in a while they've done a non-sequel, right? The last non-sequel was The Good Dinosaur, which we didn't think much of.
No, Inside Out. Same year.
Inside Out was good.
Excellent.
Yeah, Inside Out was really good.
Yeah, Good Dinosaur came afterwards, was pretty weak.
Pretty weak,
I thought.
And this movie apparently has got really great songs. So we should say it won the Best Animated Feature at the Golden Globes and at the Critics' Choice. And it was up for Best Song for Golden Globes, but was beaten by The Greatest Showman. So I think it's going to be really fun. And actually, last time I went to the cinema, we're with our baby Oscar, we're going to a parent and baby screening. And last time we went to a parent baby screening, there was a trailer for Coco. And I swear, like, he's only 4.5 months, but he got really engaged with all the colour and the music.
Amazing.
So I think I'm really excited to bring him to a kids movie. And I'm excited to see this movie. I'm a big Pixar fan. And interestingly, this is the first post-John Lasseter scandal movie to be released. Now, he's not one of the primary figures in this movie, but he was involved in the production of this movie.
Well, he would
course.
Have had creative control, maybe,
exactly.
maybe signing off decisions and all
oh,
that.
Oh, he would have been. I mean, he was the head of the studio, right?
Yeah.
So that luckily doesn't seem to have tainted the release of this, because that would have been an awful shame given what they're doing with this movie.
Yeah.
So yeah, and then I have heard that before this movie, when it was released in Mexico and in the States, there's a really long, like 20-minute Pixar Frozen short, which is apparently really terrible. So
terrible. Frozen's good though.
Yeah, Frozen is good, but apparently this isn't.
Okay.
So I hope we don't have to watch that because it's long enough in the cinema with the baby without tacking 20 minutes.
We
onto
probably
it.
Will. Here we're here now.
We're
so
here now.
All right, we'll talk to you on the other side of Coco. Oscar's very excited.
Yes. Bye.
Bye.
I know your great-great-grandpa.
Ooh.
I'll get you to him.
What are you doing?
I'm walking like a skeleton.
No, skeletons don't walk like that.
It's how you walk.
No, I don't. When there's no one left in the living world who remembers you, you disappear from this world.
But you can change that.
We gotta find my great grandpa.
You gotta do it by sunrise.
What happens at sunrise?
You'll be stuck here forever.
What?
Ugh. I'm a big fan.
Never forget how much your family loves you.
It's almost sunrise.
One cannot deny who one is meant to be.
That's you! I am terribly allergic.
But Dante doesn't have any hair.
And I don't have a nose. And yet, here we are.
Right, we're out of Coco. We're walking home. And it's... Oh, we're walking through puddles. That's
very
disgusting.
Mucky and wet. And a little bit windy.
That just floored me. That was devastating.
At one point Dave had to walk Oscar in the eyes because Oscar was crying, and then I looked over and Dave was also crying.
I was crying more than Oscar
in the aisles. It was beautiful. Though you're crying for very different reasons.
Oh my god, I noticed my tears were like falling down on top of his head.
Not at all disturbing.
Oh, that ruined me.
Yeah,
I don't know if I can even talk.
Let's talk about it briefly. And we saw when we came out that it's just been nominated for 2 Oscars.
Yeah.
So
best song and best animated picture,
which is to be guessed, really.
Sorry, we're just crossing the road here.
So
let's give a very quick synopsis of the movie.
Yes.
We won't talk spoilers yet. We'll turn to Spoiler Street in a while.
Yeah.
So the movie follows Miguel, who's a little boy in Mexico who lives in a family where music has been banned because his great-great-great-great-grandfather, there's two greats, was a musician and walked out on his great-great-grandmother. So music has been banned for generations, and he aspires to be a musician.
And he's a fantastic guitar player for a 12-year-old.
Yeah, of course.
Beautiful.
He is.
Yeah.
And his hero is one of the city's most famous musicians, Ernesto de la Cruz.
Yes.
Who's a bit of a legend. And that's so basically, he then travels into... the City of the Dead to find his ancestors, and that's the movie.
And to get his ancestors' blessing so that he can play music.
Yeah. So what did you think of this?
Okay, so I loved it. I was really moved by it as well. Now, before getting to spoilers,
go see this movie.
Go see it. It was actually a bit of a slow burner for me. Initially, I thought, okay, visually looked stunning,
it's
which
beautiful.
I knew from the trailers. Really colourful and vibrant and
both
funny.
Cities. Mexico City looks great.
It looks fabulous.
The City of the Dead looks great.
It's really beautiful. The really charming central character of Miguel, I love. I mean, Pixar always does such fantastic kid characters. Like, he's feisty and he loves his family and he loves music and he's just really sweet.
He's passionate.
Yeah.
He's likeable.
He's likeable. There's another character, Hector, who I loved, who I'll go into more details on Spoiler Street. I love that it was like a matriarchal family. So the grandmother was the centre of everything. Ruled the roost.
There's a very beautiful opening sequence in which they sort of explain his family's history through paper. Or it's not paper, it's that sort of it's those sort of cloth.
Kind of like crepe paper or something.
Yeah, crepe paper. But anyway,
it was really gorgeous visually.
It's the kind of just little creative flourishes like that.
Yeah,
that just
it
this,
looks
this
so
is
cute.
Prime Pixar.
Because remember the Good Dinosaur? This is before we did the cinema, so sadly you can't listen to our review. But we both just thought it was such a dud visually. Remember we were like, that was such an ugly... It had a cool background, but a really flat foreground of weird-looking characters, which we weren't into.
The problem with the Good Dinosaur, very quickly, is... it had photorealistic landscapes
with like 2D characters on top.
With these sort of cutesy animated characters, so that felt like a clash. And also that world felt strangely hollow.
Yeah,
like there was no depth to it. Whereas like in just one frame of this movie, there's so much going on. Amount of color and vibrancy.
The Good Dinosaur was basically from memory just The Lion King, but not as interesting.
That was weak.
And also I have more things here that I loved. I love that the way Spanish is interspersed with no explanation and no subtitles and no need for kind of, what do I mean? Like, they're not hammering in the point. They're just dusting through between Spanish and English, which
is what
people do.
Yeah, all the characters are sort of naturally bilingual.
Yeah,
although
I really enjoy
that point, I do kind of wish we were at the stage where a movie, a big budget movie like this, could just be so confident just to be in the Spanish language.
Well, it could be, animation can be in any language.
Of course it can. But I'm saying we're clearly not at that stage yet.
Pixar are an English language company. They produce for America. That's their primary audience. They're not the ones who are going to make us a foreign language cartoon.
I know. I understand the business reasons. I understand the market reasons. This is owned by Disney. I respect the reasons. But we've made so many strides to the fact that there's an entire movie set in the Mexican culture with
an
entire Disney movie. Yeah. With the Latino voice actor celebrating that. Something that's huge, global movie. Why not just go one step further and have it in the Spanish language? And partly, it bothers me that most audiences turn their noses up at foreign language movies, and that I think that is a fact. People don't like to read subtitles.
Well, it's just to be honest, if this had been made in Spanish, it would have been dubbed into English for us anyway, because animation's so easily dubbed. So I see your point, but I don't think it would have mattered to us, because like when we went to see My Life is a Courgette, we didn't watch it in French with subtitles. It was changed into English for us.
Yeah.
So animation's easily changed. And then interestingly, the music, so Remember Me, the song, which was nominated for the Golden Globe, and it lost out to The Greatest Showman, This Is Us. And so now, having seen both movies, so considering myself a complete authority on these songs, I can't believe this song didn't beat This Is Us. Now, I haven't heard the other songs in the categories, but or This Is Me, whatever the song from The Greatest Showman was. Because Remember Me is the emotional core of this movie, and it's repeated throughout, and it's so beautiful. And the song that won the prize, This Is Me or This Is Us, I can't remember which one it is, from The Greatest Showman, is not actually the song at the core of that movie. There was another song that Hugh Jackman sang throughout that movie, which I had thought was the core, and I was really surprised afterwards to hear which song had won the Golden Globe.
Yeah, but when you're judging best song, are you judging it based on how it ties into a movie, or narratively what it means, or
the song itself?
Or the song itself,
know.
And the construction of the song.
My also point is, Remember Me is better than The Greatest Showman song, like, is way it? Better. So do you remember how the song goes?
Do I remember?
do you remember?
I think
Remember
it goes,
Me?
You don't remember me, do you? Is that it?
No, it goes, what's that? Remember me when you hear a sigh, goodbye, remember me. Something like that. It's so beautiful.
Cathy just serenaded a stranger that walked by us.
So yeah, look, there are my overall thoughts on it. But I was honestly a slow burner. There was probably about 45 minutes where I thought, yeah, I'm enjoying this, but I'm enjoying it more for the setting than the plot.
Yes, okay.
And then the plot kicked in for me, which I'll speak to.
On the point of the plot, anyone who's like very familiar with movies in general, or how screenplays work, or how structure works, I think you probably won't be surprised by how this whole thing unravels. And in fact, Cathy picked the whole thing apart 20 minutes in and whispered it to me, which I wasn't very pleased with, because I hadn't got there yet. And
yeah,
the second
you always
said it,
do
I was
that
like,
to me.
I was like, oh, well, obviously it's that, because that makes perfect sense.
You always do that to me, so I got my own back.
Yeah, but anytime I do it to you, you're like, don't ever do that again. So what you it's like, and you
also,
did it.
We're not really obnoxious in the cinema, right? These parent baby cinemas have a whole different set of rules upon they're noisy, so
you
can
still
chat.
Talk too much.
You can chat during those cinemas.
You still talk too much.
But yeah, I would say it's funny thing, because it is a kid's movie, so I thought actually the fact that the plot's a bit predictable doesn't really matter, but often with Pixar they're directing it as much as to adults as they are to kids, so I was a little bit surprised the plot was that easy to pick apart.
I will say though that's not to say that the plot isn't very well constructed, because it really is. It's just not it's very conventional. The structure of this is kind of very predictable.
Yeah.
But it's still, as a story, it's very well put together, and as it unravels
beautiful.
It hits all those emotional beats, it's just elevated by the visuals, the performances, and it just packs such an emotional punch.
And I think they put so much effort into the world building that the plot, and they had an old plot I read that had actually been scrapped and they redid it again. And so if this is actually the second draft of plot, I wonder how the first one went. But this was, oh, it's all in the world building and the music. But interestingly, I loved Remember Me, and I loved all the musical numbers. But I didn't particularly notice the score, despite the fact that one of your favourite composers did it.
Michael Giacchino,
yeah. I have to say the score went over my
head. Nothing really landed for me, no. But I think the songs were the standout. On the point of the world building, or maybe we'll talk about that in spoilers.
Will we just go to spoilers? Up front, if you haven't seen it yet, don't listen to spoilers. Sure, you go and see it instead.
Just go see this movie. It's just beautiful. Mm-hmm.
And you may guess the ending, but still don't listen to us first, because it's still a beautiful ending.
Oh, okay. Right, we are turning onto
spoiler
the
street.
Muckiest
it's
spoiler
muddy.
Street we've ever done. We're walking down by the Thames at the moment.
Very mucky. You may hear the sound of the buggy on the ground, which is adding some nice sound.
All right, so we are now officially in spoiler street, and we can say that, you know, the name of this movie is Coco, and when you realize why,
yeah,
she's like this great grandmother has just been sitting there in the background. You're kind of only introduced to her briefly, and then you realize that she's the entire emotional core of the whole thing.
We've been wondering, like, because I kept thinking until I actually started watching this movie, I always thought it was called Coco because that was the little boy's name.
Coco, yeah.
And then when the movie started and he was called Miguel and he says, "This is my grandmother Coco," again, I just kind of went, okay.
Great grandmother.
Forgetting about the name of the movie, and it really just hits you right at the end. It's her story, and that's why the movie's called Coco, and
well,
that really
and
sneaks
Hector's
up on you.
Story.
Yeah, and so we need to speak about Hector, right? So basically, for anyone who's listening and hasn't seen the movie,
why are you listening? We told
you
not to.
Yeah, we told you not to, first
of
all.
Go and watch the movie.
So the little boy Miguel believes Ernesto to be his great-great-great-grandfather and is searching for him in the land of the dead. However, Ernesto turns out to be a bit of a bad guy.
Wait, they know all this? They've heard it?
They know. No, I'm saying for someone who hasn't watched it.
I just told them to go.
Okay.
Listen, you people, why are you still here? Go and watch the movie.
He actually stole the songs from Hector, who turns out to be Miguel's grandfather, which I guessed really early on. But Hector, I love what they did with his character, because without him changing how he acted, he had a complete character arc, which is really unusual. Usually you see a character in such a different light between the beginning and end of a movie because of something they do. But in this movie, we saw him in a completely different light, not through his actions, but through our understanding. So what appears to be at the beginning that he's just this comic relief character, right? He's trying to like get into Sky so he can run across the bridge and see his living family, and we just think he's this chancer. He says he's a musician and he knows Ernesto. We just think he's like bullshitter. His desperation comes across as like he's probably got some issues and is not a nice guy, and he's like potentially a bad guy.
Yeah, I totally thought he was comic relief.
Yeah, and then at the end, he's actually, you know, he's Coco's father, and he wrote Remember Me.
Yeah.
To sing to her every night when they were apart, he would sing it and she would sing it, and it was just so beautiful.
Like, this is vintage, like, Pixar at its best. And I, like, we saw it in Up, we've seen it at the end of Toy Story 3, which was the same director, Lee Unkrich. They set the groundwork with that flashback of him singing the song, which by itself is
oh
just
God.
Had me
wasn't
in
a dry
tears.
Eye in the house, including wailing babies.
And that they set the groundwork up for that finale, and you know it's coming. You just know, you knew.
I mean, the song has to be sung again.
You knew the second that happened that where it was going and how it was going to play out. But oh my God, I could not bear it. I was just in convulsions in the aisle, holding my son and watching this. And that's what's so beautiful about this movie, because the themes are all about
family
and and remembering, and I think
and like your family will live as long as you remember them, whether or not they're with you or not, which is such a gorgeous message for anyone, but like also children.
What a beautiful lesson for
particularly children.
What a beautiful way to sort of appreciate and understand mortality.
Yeah,
because and I know a lot of this now, to be fair, they didn't create this, that it's rooted in Mexican culture.
Yeah, and of course this festival exists and people put pictures of their relatives up to remember them. And they just incorporated that so cleverly because in the movie, it's if you can't cross over the bridge to the other side on the night of, what's it called, the Night of the Dead?
Day of the Dead.
Unless your family has put a photo of you up on Earth, and that goes through like a photo scanning machine like in an airport, which is quite funny. Honestly, for a Pixar movie, it was low on laughs.
I disagree. I got a few.
Yeah, but relative to other movies, like you mentioned Toy Story and Up, it's a lovely movie. I'm not criticizing it, but it's not one of the funny ones. It's quite a serious movie, I think. And it's dealing with a lot of issues, and it is actually
it's not
PG.
Serious, it's playful.
Okay, we can agree. I'm just talking relative to other Pixar movies.
Maybe the comedy is more for children because it's a lot of slapstick.
Yeah, it's
and
visual.
And
yeah, like skeletons.
The skeletons' heads coming off.
But it's interesting. Did you notice it's PG, not G? And I think a lot of that might be the skeleton imagery, but also there is what I would have considered like a scene of peril for Miguel. And I can see how it wouldn't be maybe suitable for very young kids.
Yes, and... in a way, it's constructed very much like Up was, in that there's this hero character that they discover later in a different world, like the old man in Up, who turns out to be the villain.
Yeah.
There's a lot of similarities to the structure.
I did enjoy the villain. I really enjoyed him. I thought he was fantastic.
He was fun.
And my favourite
scene... I think it was
Benjamin
Pratt, wasn't it?
I think so. Aside from the Remember Me sequence, which just blew my mind, the other scene that I loved was... when little Miguel and his unbeknownst to him at the time grandfather Hector perform a musical number on stage in this talent competition, and I just thought that was really fantastic looking and like really beautiful sounding.
I thought the way music was woven into this movie was very clever and touching, and how music plays such an important part with memory, and there's a lot of music therapy used when it comes to treating Alzheimer's and dementia.
Yeah.
Which you wouldn't expect an animated kids movie to deal with, but it really does full on. I mean, that is what brings Coco back.
Yeah.
That's what brings her memories back.
And they really capture that song visually, because up until that point, we're going to need a bit of a job here in the buggy through this muck.
It's the worst path. We're not doing this again.
No, not on a wet day. Visually, Coco goes from this, what you would say is like a shrunken, you know, shell of a woman, like in the corner of the room, completely slumped over, to visibly just lighting up. She lights up the screen. Her whole family are like gaping in shock because you get the impression she hasn't really done that for years.
You're gonna make me cry.
And then the song kicks in and they sing it together, and it's like this, exactly what animation should be, which is like visually and then with, because I think the best animations are always the ones with music, visually and together with music. You just get this sublime moment, and it's just a medium perfect for that. That, you know, you can't, I just don't think you can get in a live action get in an animation.
I'll tell you why this got to me on so many levels, right? Firstly, it's perfectly constructed to make you cry. As
yeah.
I said, they've set the groundwork. They've got a beautiful song. It's the perfect like emotional situation. But secondly, it digs deeper because, as I said, it's about ancestry. It's about your place in the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's about growing old, and I was able to see myself as Miguel and as Coco, and I was holding my son. I was remembering my grandparents. Two of my grandparents have had dementia and have passed, and all of that, just like all those emotions, just came swirling back, and I found it very profound. I
yeah.
was absolutely torn to shreds.
Aww. And that's what it, you know, that's the sign of a really beautiful family movie, which is what this is, that can be enjoyed by anyone.
It's superb. And
yeah.
I know these movies can come under criticism. You mentioned it being PG for, you know, having quite potentially emotionally distressing scenes for children. And obviously we didn't have any children present. It was babies who were under one and shitting and screaming and all the adults. But I think these things are important to help kids understand their place in the world and how life and death works.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm about to sneeze.
Oh, I thought you were about to cry.
No. What I love about it is it's talking death in very nice terms, which is that they're still around you as spirits and they're still there for you as long as you remember them. And that's just like a lovely message.
Now, however, once we came out of this, and I sort of gathered my senses and started actually thinking about how this City of the Dead would work, it kind of falls apart. So some of them were like, obviously it has to be sort of simple world building, but I found it slightly disturbing that there's still a class divide in the afterlife. Did you find that? Like, there's this guy who's a celebrity who's living in literally in like an ivory palace.
Well, that's because he said he gets all these people in the live world leave him all these gifts that translate over to the world of the dead.
Yeah, so basically what, he's still earning a fortune in there.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Then you've the characters like Hector, and at one stage he visits the slums of the people who've been forgotten. Like, I found that, if you actually unpick that, like, people die and then go to this afterlife where, hey, you continue to be either dirt poor or mega
rich. Yeah,
it
was like, if no one remembers you, forget about it, man, which is really sad, because if you could picture a situation where you were like, I don't know, like an only child and you'd no relatives, and I'm talking now if you're a little kid, and you could think, wait, what if that happens to me? Like, I could die and no one would remember me. But I don't think a kid would probably pull that out of it. But it is, like, I guess they just basically made it reflective of the real world, but just in the City of the Dead. And we have to talk about the love story, the way Hector and Coco's Miguel's great-great-grandmother in the end are
Coco's
reunited.
Mother, yeah.
I loved that. I thought that was really sweet.
Yeah, that was nice.
Yeah.
One thing that the whole thing reminded me of was Grim Fandango. It's a PC game in the 90s by the guys who did Monkey Island. It was a click adventure game. Amazing game. But, like, great, again, very similar. It's set in the City of the Dead, and it's sort of a detective mystery, and it looks very much like this. I wonder.
I mean, I'm sure a 90s video game looks slightly less good than this new Pixar movie.
Well, obviously, the graphics are a little more polished.
Yeah.
In this one. On the whole, you know, progressiveness of this, and I do think it is. It's a massive step forward, and we're just a step in the right direction. But there was. I do remember reading about some controversy around Disney and this movie, because they tried to copyright the phrase Dia de los Muertos.
Oh yes, I heard about that. I read that too.
To use on merchandise.
It's like, Disney, please, like, do you have to be so culturally stupid? You're just stupid anyway. You can't.
That, like, is literal cultural appropriation. That's like, we are going to buy the rights to your culture. Like, now they came under such fire that they backed down.
Well,
but
they wouldn't get it. Like, you can't copyright something like that.
It's
like, that's
bullshit.
So stupid.
It's like if suddenly 20th Century Fox bought St. Patrick's Day.
I know, yeah. It makes no sense. And it is interesting. We did see pop up pretty early on in the credits after the directors and writers was executive producer John Lasseter. So I wonder what... Apparently he's only on a 6-month break from Pixar and Disney for his behaviour. But I wonder if he'll ever come back again, and if he'll... Because there's such a long reach of those movies, right? They work like 5 years out. His name's going to be cropping up for quite some time on those movies, whether or not he stays. So that's interesting. But I think, we should wrap this up. Wholehearted endorsement from both of us. Big, big, big improvement on The Good Dinosaur, which was their last one. And I'm also just really glad that they're doing an original movie again. Now, I hope they don't make a sequel to this. I want them to keep doing original movies and not just more Cars movies.
Well,
which
there's
we
gonna,
would never
there's
go and
gonna
see.
Be, like, this is, but this is the... Since Disney bought them, 5 years ago for $6 billion or whatever, that's the nature of this business. They're, for every original idea, you're going to get two sequels now.
Yeah. Oh, and speaking of sequels, we didn't mention the Frozen short, a.k.a. the 20-minute Frozen thing, was luckily not in front of our movie, but because they... I don't know if it was just the cinema we went to decided not to screen it, or if it's not being screened in the UK at all. But then we didn't get a nice actual Pixar short, which is what I love at the start of those movies. So I guess they listened to the complaints of people, particularly in Mexico, who were going to see Coco, a movie about their own culture, and instead had to watch a 20-minute Frozen short about two white girls singing at each other, which was just not what, you know, people were going to see. So it's a shame though, because one of my favourite things of the Pixar is always to see the little shorts beforehand.
Alright.
Yeah, so that's it. Loved it. Happy to be at the cinema again together.
Let us know. Yes, I know, it's been ages. Oscar's awake, hello. Let us know what you thought of Coco, what you think of Pixar in general. We're at The Cinemile on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram. Please, if you enjoyed this, head to the Apple Podcasts app or whatever you're listening to this on, and subscribe to us if you haven't already, or just leave us a review. You don't have to write anything. You can just tap the stars.
Yes. And we're on the Acast network, so you can find us there if you have the Acast app. And mainly we just want you to go and see Coco because it's really nice.
Yes.
And poll if people prefer Remember Me or The Greatest Showman song, or if you care at all.
Right, we'll do that.
Yes.
Is that the third option?
Yeah.
Do you care at all?
Do you care at all?
That'll be on our Twitter page. Yes. As soon as you are hearing this.
Okay, bye.
All right, bye everyone.
Remember me, though I have to say goodbye. Remember me, don't let it make you cry. For even if I'm far away, I hold you in my heart. I sing a secret song to you each night we are apart. Remember me. Though I have to travel far, remember me. Each time you hear a sad guitar, know that I'm with you.